And let's carry on this discussion. It's important. Joining us now via Zoom is psychology expert and life coach, Dr. Cheyenne Bryant. Doctor, thank you so much for joining
us.
Good morning. It's so good to see you, especially on an issue of such importance. So as we just heard from our piece, there is a stigma in communities of color for reaching out with any issue of mental health or mental illness. How do we get past those barriers so that we can give folks the tools they need to reach the help, to seek the help they need?
Yeah, good morning, Melvin. Good morning, Giselle. And happy Monday. You know, one of the tools that's really important is we need more people who look like us in this field. There's only 4% of psychologists that are Black in the mental health field. And obviously, I'm one of those 4%, right? Why is that important? Because cultural competence is top of importance when it comes to African Americans, specifically males, going to seek help. It is very important that they see someone who either looks like them, understands them, and allows them to be in their authentic form when expressing the traumas that they've experienced that has gotten them to a place of depression, a place of anxiety. And another reason for that is when you don't have folks that understand the culture, that leaves African Americans to be either under or overdiagnosed, right? That means that they can then run the risk of being mismedicated or undertreated. And that is a big issue for a community that already does not have access to healthcare. And as we know, healthcare disparities has been an ongoing thing in our community from the beginning of time.
Yeah.
You raise such a great point. This whole idea of cultural competency. I studied human development and counseling in graduate school, and this is, you know, such an important thing that we talked about a lot, especially in multicultural counseling, that this is the way to reach people, and there's a very specific way that you do that. So, because every cultural community has different issues. So what tips can you share with folks to help them be able to prioritize their mental health?
You know, Melvin, I'm gonna make it as simplistic as possible because that's another thing that we need to start doing as clinicians. We have a certain clinical language that we speak within our constituents, correct, within our industry. Yeah. But guess what? That language isn't always understood when it's coming across to our clients or to the public who are not in the field of mental health. So I'll make it very simple. There's one tip. The very first sign of sadness, of guilt, of shame, of suicidal ideations, that one tip is to seek help. There is power in seeking help. Getting help is powerful. Now listen, seeking help does not mean turning to family or friends. They are great for debriefing and they're great to guide you into the right direction, but they're not mental health professionals. And they oftentimes can cause additional impairments because they don't know how to treat that at which you're experiencing. Another thing is there's a difference between diagnosis and symptoms. You know, we can wake up and have a bad day and we can start to exhibit symptoms of depression. That does not mean we are depressed. Mm-hmm. We can just be experiencing daily impairments, life impairments. And you have to have an experienced, culturally competent therapist, mental health professional, coach like myself who understands that. So we don't misdiagnose, mm-hmm. mistreat you by saying you're depressed and giving you that title when you're just having a bad day, a bad week. And sometimes some of us have bad months and we want to be able to have folks understand, listen, this is something we can process out, but you don't have this type of diagnosis. You don't have this, this mental health illness, which is a big, big stigma in the African-American community.
Boy, so clear, truth to power.
That's right.
It's so powerful. Mm-hmm. You know, and oftentimes in the absence of, you know, mental health help, people turn to drugs, and then that's how it's defined as addiction and shame as opposed to addressing root causes. Have you seen this as well in your experience?
Giselle, you're spot on. That's called self-medicating. And in our community, unfortunately, that is where we turn to a couple things. Those couple things are substance abuse, like you just mentioned, and it is church, right? Mm-hmm. And church is not a bad thing. And I'm big on prayer. I believe that, you know, prayer is a good entryway. However, faith without works is dead, right? And so prayer without doing the work, which is where the mental health professionals come in at, it's dead. And what it does is if you're praying and you're doing no work to back it up, guess what it does? It disempowers the person because now they're feeling like, wait, prayer doesn't work? What am I not doing, right? Am I not deserving of a better quality of life? Am I not deserving of coming out of this darkness? And so it becomes disempowering. And so we have to bring the awareness and the information out to say, listen, you can get help. And there's different places. There's a really good organization called EnoPsych, and which makes them amazing is they connect Black therapists with Black clients. And that is what we need. We need the liaison, the connector, the bridge between Black therapists, because there isn't many of us, and Black clients so that they can get the help that they obviously much need.
And, you know, this is, you're fantastic. First of all, you are fantastic.
Can you move in?
You are fantastic. And I think, the point, there's so much shame, you know, and I love the point that you made, too, about our family and friends are great, and they're good to debrief things, but sometimes you need to seek out some help. I had to give me a little support and go back to hop into some therapy just recently because I had, you know, I got my friends and I had people that can support me and listen, but I needed to do a deeper dive because there needs to be that delineation because you can't just count on them over and over again. So let me just ask you before we go, what does it mean to you to be somebody that Black folks look to seek out help? It's like you're giving them this permission that it's okay. You know, we talk a lot on the show about representation. You got to see it to be it. And you are such a resource for so many people. So what does it mean to you to be that for Black folks?
Melvin, I always say you can only be what you see. That is what I tell my clients. I preach it all day long. And it means the world to me because I was a little girl who came from the inner city. And I was a little girl who experienced abandonment, and I had my own traumas that I had to work through. And so for me to be able to take my broken pieces and make peace from that and bring those tips and that experience on the how to do it to my community. And let me be clear, I enjoy bringing that to human beings in general because I think it's a human right to have a peace of mind. But to be able to do it specifically to my people, to my community, when I know we're underrepresented in the mental health field, but we're overrepresented in the prisons. And let me say this really quick. Studies show that African-Americans who are diagnosed with a mental health illness have a rate of 3 times more to end up in prison. You know, this field saves lives. And so to answer your question, it means everything to me for me to give back what I've experienced firsthand. And I'm not just a coach or, you know, a mental health professional who I'm speaking from a book. I'm speaking from cultural competence and experience. And the key thing is I've allowed my clients to be who they are and come in the space of their trauma. Because when you are treating someone, you're treating their trauma. Until you unravel that trauma from who they are, do you get to experience that beautiful person that they've always been? And until then, you got to let them come in. Trauma's not pretty. You got to let them come in a little rough at the edges, come in expressing themselves the way they were taught. And that's what culture competence allows us professionals to do.
Words so powerful, especially as the government just put out this study that says racism is causing mental illness in this country. Dr. Bryant, you rock.
I want to say kudos, Melvin, to you for getting the help that you need. You are a leader in our community for being the Black man who is seeking help. You're powerful. I want to tell you that. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Bryant. Thank you. We'll be back, everybody. No shame.
That's right.